Commissioner Patton.
Here.
Commissioner Barwick.
Here.
Commissioner Webb.
Here.
Commissioner Stecklin.
Here.
Mayor Ashber.
Here. United States Marine. Ed Davis, would you mind leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I ask all those who are veterans, please salute. Those non-veterans, please place your right hand over your heart. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So, Mr. Davis, don't sit down. Come up and talk to us. Yes, please. This is our item number three on the agenda, which is audience to visitors. And Ed has been instrumental in the organization that runs the Veterans Parade each fall in Marion. And so he's here to update us on that effort.
Thank you, Mayor. I appreciate the council giving me this early time so I can get home early tonight. For the last 6 to 8 weeks, as many of you have dealt with this virus and this pandemic, about planning something in your personal life or your private life or your business life has been very difficult. It was difficult for me and my committee to decide whether or not we should have a parade in Marion that entails having older and younger veterans on parade and bringing out veterans along the sidelines to appreciate and thank those heroes. Well, like I said, we finally had a meeting last night and came to the fruition that we are going to have the parade this year. We are not giving up. It is an outside event. We're going to take some precautions, and we'll address those later as we get closer to the date. The original date was supposed to be September the 12th at 10 a.m., which is a Saturday. It's always the first Saturday after Labor Day, because that's the closest day to the Patriots Day holiday, of which we feel that there's nobody more patriotic than a veteran. That's why we chose that time frame. I met with the mayor today, and at the discussions with my committee, we have decided to have this parade delayed probably approximately a month. We're either going to be looking at October the 10th or October the 17th. I've got an email when I go home tonight and email my committee about the dates that the mayor and I talked about. You know, we want to have this parade, but we don't want to infringe on maybe another function or another happenstance that's going on in the city. We don't want to, you know, take over their spot. So once we get that checked out, and the mayor and I, you know, we agreed that, you know, there are some veterans that may not show up, but when three veterans and I started this parade almost 16 years ago and planned it, we always said that, and I made the statement, that if there was one veteran who wanted to walk down Main Street and show their, and let people show their appreciation, I'd be right alongside them. So if there's one veteran or 500 veterans, there's going to be veterans coming down Main Street sometime in October, God willing, that things lighten up a little bit. So, but we're planning on it. So again, I appreciate what the city does. You know, we have a great police department here. I met with the chief today. We have a great fire department. We have Brian Fisher, Terrence. I mean, everybody in this room that works for this city helps us do what we do every year. And it's become such a great, I think, not because I'm a veteran, but because it's a great community and patriotic event that we need to have in this country. We're certainly short of it. We don't have enough. And again, you may not agree with me, but that's how I feel. I gave almost 4 years of my life to this country. And I think people should take a look out there and thank those, especially our older veterans who we're losing day by day. So again, we will have that parade in October. Mayor, thank you for your time. Everybody, I hope you'll come out whichever day it is, and you'll see ads, and you'll hear me on the radio with my voice. My Brooklyn accent comes across. They look at me and go,
"Where's I thought that guy? Was Johnson County."
Okay, Johnson County, I'll take it. It's Southern Illinois. Thank you, everybody. Mayor, thanks for your time.
Thank you.
We'll see you soon.
All right.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ed.
I know Before I open it up to anybody else that'd like to speak, audience to visitors, Terrence Henry, who's a IT director for the city of Marion, has some words he'd like to say based on an event that happened over the weekend to his family. So I'd like to invite him to the podium and anybody else he'd like to bring to share that with us, please. After which I would like to say something.
Try to get the crew all in here. And Eva the Diva. All right. Try to not break down, but this is something that's very true and dear to our family. If some of you guys may or may not have heard, but on Saturday, we had a situation that went bad at my house. Our niece almost drowned, trying to help other kids learn how to swim. In that whole process, and I wasn't even at home at the time, the people that you see here, Mr. Pete, back over there as well, so you should also come up here as well, you know. But these are the crew of people that went through and helped my niece live and survive today. And again, I'm trying to get through this, sorry. So my niece was laying on the bottom of the pool. The rest of the kids went through and was able to save one of the kids and got him into the shallow side. My niece and I dove in, you know. You can come over this way. She dove in to 12 feet of water and got her older sister out, that's bigger than her, and got her out of the pool and up to the top, where her mom went through and started to work on administering CPR. At that time, they hollered for help. And then my little sister, Alicia, who's here from Springfield, she dialed 911, and they said, go get help. And then Eva the Diva also sprung into action, and she ran across the street to go get Pete. Pete comes over to the house, and he takes over and works on the CPR and help get the fluid and everything else out of my niece's lungs, and was able to do that and brought her back to life. So my brother and the rest of the family were so amazed also by our first responders that showed up on scene. And my brother is a lieutenant with the Department of Corrections out of Missouri area. And my family, besides my kids, are from Alton. And my niece is from Houston. So they're not from here. My brother said that when all of this happened, they came in like a SWAT team. He said he'd never seen anything like it. And the professionalism that the Marion Police Department displayed. And Mr. Sloan, I know you're here with us. He's talking about you. Man, thanks, cuz, you know. But, you know, and the United, you know, Ambulance Services was there. Mr. Willis has been contacting my brother every day, asking for updates. We thank you guys for that. When the Marion Police Department got there, you know, they didn't see a race. They saw a life. And that is important. In this day and age, they didn't see a race. They saw a life, and they went to that life, and they assisted and helped. Mr. Pete did not see a wife, a life. You know, they saw a life and assisted in that. And that is what's important. And my niece is able to be alive today because no one hesitated. No one panicked. You got kids that all jumped in. A neighbor of Mr. Pete needed a couple minutes to get his shoes on. Every second counted. And because of that and this fast response of everyone, you know, on behalf of the Henry family, you know, we definitely say thank you for saving the life of my niece, my brother's daughter, and then some. And my brother, wish he can be here today, but he's still in St. Louis with his daughter. He told me to again thank the Marion Police Department and the rest of the first responders that were there that was following up. You know, we're a secretive family. You didn't see all the stuff on Facebook. We don't put our business out. But when something is due to say thank you, we would definitely step up and do that. And I can't describe it enough. And the words and the encouragement and the phone calls, you know, I broke down a few times from people calling me. You know, I'm not used to all that, but definitely appreciate it. And I just wanted to say thank you once again.
Hey, Terrence, could you bring your family kind of over here so we can
keep you up there? Can you guys move over that way a little bit? Okay.
Did you want to read this letter?
No, sir. I did paraphrase it.
Hey. So this is Steve's. Give it to him when it's time, okay? Mr. Gordon, this is Pete Gordon to my right in the red West Frankfort Redbird t-shirt. What? That is a little bit of sacrilege.
Well, we are a divided family. My wife works at Marion Unit 2, and I teach and coach at West Frankfort. So,
under these circumstances, we're going to forgive you tonight.
My kids are wildcats. She tells me that every day. So.
Okay. This is, I'm sure you didn't give it a second thought, but... And thank God. But we wanted, as a city, not just because Terrence works for the city, but we wanted to give you a very small token of appreciation. And I'll just read this into the public record. It does say certificate of appreciation. This is to certify that Pete Gordon is hereby recognized for showcasing incredible bravery by performing CPR on a young woman who was in distress. On behalf of a grateful city, we thank you, awarded this 13th day of July 2020. It's sealed and has my signature, but maybe even more importantly, that's going to sit on a shelf someplace. This is something relatively new. I'm going to take it out so it doesn't shine. I call these spirit coins, or challenge coins as they're called in military circles, and I had these made for special reasons. I give them out for special reasons. If you think of it, it's a modern incarnation of the key to the city, because I thought that was an outdated thing that didn't make a lot of sense, and I thought this was something somebody can carry on their person, in their pocket, share with somebody else, show them what it's all about. So the condition of you receiving this is you got to take this to West Frankfort. But anyway, it simply says on the front, it's got Marion's logo with the proper hues. Commissioner Stecklin, it says the year 2020, and my plan is to have a new one of these each year printed up. And on the back, it has the Marion United logo, which if any of you might remember those, that's the kind of the Statue of Liberty-like fist holding the Tower Square clock tower. And it says Marion United, but on the top it says the Oasis of Opportunity since 1839. So that's the official new city logo, by the way. Or catchphrase. So anyway, I hope this means something to you. It's as short of, if it's this short of notice, it's all I could come up with, but it comes from the heart and it comes out of sincerity. And you're not just a good neighbor, but you're a godly man. We appreciate you. So thank you. I will shake your hand. If you'll stay up here too, you've got this one. We had three police officers and two ambulance attendants. Three? How many came to the scene?
Five of them.
Oh, my gosh. I got to get more coins. That's okay. I've got them. We had three police officers that attended the scene. We have one of them with us here tonight. That's Officer Sloan, Stephen Sloan. And your certificate says much the same. You're hereby recognized for your incredible bravery in rescuing a young woman who was in distress. On behalf of a grateful city, we thank you, awarded this 13th day of July with the city seal and my signature. Commissioner Barwick's going to give this to you while I unwrap this coin. And I know you already have one of these coins. But it's a tough time to be a police officer in the United States of America right now. And we appreciate you. We appreciate you. So here's number two. This is the second one you've got for me, I believe, is it not?
Yep.
So we appreciate you, Steve. Thank you so much. Thank you. Want to say something?
I just
There's one thing that you don't know that definitely needs to be mentioned. It doesn't have anything to do with this event, but it did happen over the weekend, and that is Officer Sloan stopped a suicide in progress. I'm not going to go into any further details, not to embarrass anyone, but he stopped a suicide in progress, and the person is still alive and with us today. We are proud of you.
So the next time somebody says something about a police officer, remember this night. Remember what happened this weekend. The two other officers were Chuck Welch and and Trent Harrison. One is on vacation. One may be on duty. Is that right? Do I have that right?
He got sent to a call just before we started.
Okay, so I'm going to give you these certificates.
Yes,
I want to save the coins and give them to them personally so I can shake their hand if you don't mind.
Absolutely.
But I think I'll ask you to come here with me. But this was excellent service. And I did not get all of your names that were from United, so I want you to come up and tell me who all attended this scene. I don't want to discount your service in any way, and I will absolutely get you your certificates too.
So there were a total of five personnel from our organization on the scene. Three of us are paramedics. Two of us were EMTs. We had Derek Gaither, the Division 3 captain from Heron, who was in town in his supervisor vehicle helping us cover, because we had quite a few 911 calls that day. I was staffing an ambulance, Michael Willis. My partner was Joe Vaughn, one of our EMTs. And then Tristan Houseworth, who's next to me, one of our EMTs, was staffing a truck with Cynthia Campbell, one of our paramedics. So there's a total of five of us. And from start to finish, if there was any way a bad call like this should have went, this is the way it needs to go. From the 911 dispatchers, to law enforcement, AeroVac, the fire department setting up the landing zone, everyone really came together to make the difference in this. It's called chain of survival. And if you ever hear that term, this is exactly what chain of survival means. So good job to everyone.
Yes, it was a good job. I need to give you the ones to give to your other folks that weren't here, or would you make them come back up and let you
know? I would be glad to bring them to the next meeting or at a day
it's up to you.
No, I'd love to bring them. Yeah. I would love to do that.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
You're very welcome, sir.
Thank you.
When he says chain of survival, seconds matter, training matters, personnel matters, and equipment matters. And these are the things, mainly the people and the skills training, that saves lives. And literally, Terrence, I don't want to bring up something sad and frightful because I know how frightful it was, but seconds would have mattered. Yeah. Seconds mattered. Somebody leaping across a pool mattered. Some young person diving down into a pool, I don't know where she at.
Yeah, that's the night. That's the back.
You went down and got her? It mattered, hon. Would you like to say something? It mattered.
Yeah,
you did good.
I did.
You did good.
I just want to thank everybody from when I called to say my niece. I really appreciate y'all, because if it wasn't for y'all, she probably would have died. And I'm just saying, God has come, blessed us a long way. Thank you again.
Okay. We are still in number three on the agenda, which is our public comments and audience to visitors. I'm sorry for capitalizing on that time, but we had some good stories to tell you about and some people to honor. So is there anybody else that'd like to speak? Dennis, go ahead. Come on up. Dennis, my campaign mate from April 2019.
Thank you. Thank you, Mike. It was very nice to be here. I didn't expect to be here, but I'm glad I'm here, because I've been on the road from Florida to Tennessee to Kentucky to Illinois. But on my travels, quickly, I want you to know we have a beautiful corn crop that is north of Marion and probably around here too. But it's amazing. The greatness of this state, in my opinion, is agriculture. And the amount of product, whether it's corn, wheat, barley, soybeans, all of those kinds of commodities that designate and distinguish Illinois from every other state within the breadbasket of the United States, I think is very, very powerful. And I just wanted to say that. I know this is the first meeting since COVID-19 outside of having people come here. I'm really honored to be here. I think, Mike, you're doing an excellent job. I think under the circumstances, I don't think I could have done any better. And
I appreciate you saying that, Dennis.
You bet. You bet. So let us proceed, family, and move it forward. If you're not working for your family, who are you fighting for?
Thank you, Mr. Ball. Anybody else like to speak to the council in public comments, audience to visitors? All right, we will move on to our consent agenda. We have items A through G tonight. Is there anybody on the council before we have a motion to pass that would like any of these items, A through G, removed from the consent agenda and voted upon separately? Would anybody from the audience that has any of these items, A through G, prefer to have these items voted on separately by the council? If not, I'd entertain a motion to pass the consent agenda as presented.
I make a motion. Go ahead.
Would make a motion that we would approve the consent agenda as given.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, any discussion or questions on any of these items? Okay, roll call, please.
Commissioner Patton?
Yay.
Commissioner Barwick?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Stecklin?
Yay.
Mayor Abscher?
Yay. Under new business, item five, as you guys may have recalled, obviously we had a resignation that's from the, or not resignation, retirement, I should say, from the Senior Citizen Center. Latina Poole is retiring at the end of this month. And after a search for her replacement, I have a recommendation in front of you, to which I've communicated to you privately. Jill Lindsay Graskowitz as director of the Senior Citizen Program starting which date are you going to work? Okay, so she's going to start a little bit before Latina leaves, hopefully, and you might want to wait to go up to the podium until we actually approve your hire, so hang on just a second. So that was engineered that way, so there's a little bit of overlap, I should say, so that they can work together, but I'll introduce her to you guys here in a moment, if you so desire, if you so approve. Somebody want to make that motion?
I make a motion to the mayor's recommendation to hire Jill Lindsay
Graskowitz
as a director at the salary of $50,000 plus benefits effective July 27th, 2020.
I'll second that.
Okay, roll call, please.
Commissioner Patton?
Yay.
Commissioner Barwick?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Stecklin?
Yay.
Mayor Abscher?
Yay. All right, Jill, would you like to introduce yourself to the community and just briefly and then to the commissioners?
Sure. Hello, my name is Jill Graskowitz. I have worked with seniors for about the last 20 years. It's one of my passions. I believe in culture change because if we don't change it now, it's going to be you and I living in the same America that we know for seniors right now. So we need to step it up and give them some new opportunities. So it's a pleasure and I'm very excited.
Normally we have you guys, any new hire come and shake hands. We'll probably just forego that for the moment, but we'll look forward to that. And I know you guys, they were apprised of all your ideas and plans as you shared those with me. So I know a couple of them at least commented back to me and how exciting some of those were. That was an off-the-cuff thing I asked her to come up with, and the age of COVID-19, how we move forward with the Senior Citizen Center. And you pretty much, by that night or the next morning, had three or four pages worth of them. So it was pretty impressive. So we're looking forward to it. And just a couple weeks, right? You start? All right. You have, was your husband here with you? Did you want to introduce? Also from West Frankfort?
Yeah.
What the heck?
I know.
We're getting.
It's an invasion.
Better known as Lee and Johnny.
Oh, okay. Awesome. Gotcha. Yeah. Well, I think you got a winner here.
And we got a.
And we do too.
Got a counselor that's got some pretty deep roots in Frankfurt too. I said we have a counselor down here that's got some pretty deep roots in Frankfurt.
It is an invasion. Okay, item number six. One of the opportunities that I had coming in was overtime to build my own team, if you will, in the administration, and I will admit that that took some time. As a matter of fact, the person I introduced you to started in May, but it took me every bit of a year to hire her. So worked on that two or three different times. I finally came up with a set of things that she's passionate about to work on, I think. I hope I'm not overstating this, that she agreed to come to work for the city of Marion, and I am so grateful that she did. So this is Allison Hasler. Her title's Community Program Director. That's a made-up title because we combined about three jobs, right, of things that I needed done and that you thought you could accomplish, and that's just kind of the umbrella term that we came up with. So you kind of asked me about Allison and what she was doing. I thought this would be a great time for her to briefly tell you a little bit about what she's been doing after getting her feet wet starting in May and all the exciting projects she's working on behalf of the city. So, Allison.
Okay. Thank you for your time, Council. I'm Allison, as the mayor mentioned. I'm not really sure if the title fits just yet. I know that what it feels like is a special projects manager in some regard, with a whole lot of grant administration and a whole lot of community engagement, which I'm excited about both of those. So I just wanted to run through just really quickly some of the things that I've been working on, a few things that we have submitted and is kind of waiting in the wings, and then also some things that are kind of moving forward. So one of the first things that I did before the end of May was submit, along with a pretty large team here, a $3.2 million fast track public infrastructure grant for a elevated water storage tank and water main for the east side of Marion. That is still waiting in the wings. We haven't heard back yet. If it is not approved or only partially approved, we can turn that right back around and apply for the infrastructure grant out of the same track. I did get one response back. It was a mini grant from Walmart and Sam's Club. It's PPE for the Marion Fire Department. It was $1,450. One that I'm very excited about is the National Endowment for the Arts Our Town Project. It's an award for $150,000 award ceiling. It is a one-to-one match, but we're going to use those funds to implement one of the many visions that the mayor had about revitalizing the downtown. So what the project focus for that is going to be for public art, where we're going to render building murals, hopefully 5 to 8 building murals with these funds, and we're going to, along the lines of really involving the community in that process and moving forward with a really great programmatic style of effort. So it'll be a lot of community engagement, probably a really awesome ribbon cutting of some sort. I already have some ideas for that for next year when they come up. Let's see, there's a couple other ones that I'm researching right now. One of them is a construction grant for the Illinois Public Library. It's an award ceiling of $125,000, but it looks like something that we could maybe use for an HVAC system for the library. And it looks like I'm doing a few other things, looking for tire disposal, crosswalk signage, looking at some ways that we can use some historic preservation funds for the bank building. Let's see. Mosquito abatement, some other things that are going on too. So that's pretty much my grants as of right now that I'm working on. For TIF funds, I am in the process of drafting a roadmap for the residential TIF that'll be coming up, and really researching what the best practices are from across the country. Miscellaneous things, which kind of more in that project management piece, is we're looking at doing a fall harvest, some sort of festival on the square for fall, a holiday market, which I have a lot of great ideas for a holiday market, along with a really exceptional committee that we've been working on with some community leaders and Marion United, and just a lot of great, great minds at the table. And then really just pulling the city data, the what we already have, finding out what those resources are and leveraging those resources. So that's it, and I would love to take any questions if you have them.
You guys got questions? No?
Okay. Thank you, Council.
Excellent. Thank you, Allison.
Thank you, Allison.
Okay, item number 7 under Public Works. We've got a, are you going to talk about this, Brent? I'll just let you introduce it then. It's Copper.
Yeah, it looks like we've got a few things on here. I guess the first item is the purchase that we need to make. The water department has been working for a few years now trying to replace all the water meters in town to the new Zenner meters. Cliff Hogue Jr. has a list of the final, I think, 324 meters, give or take, depending on how many he's changed since he told me this number. But these are meters that were going to be hard to replace for either in a house, they're a straight connection to the water mains, something of that sort. But we need to purchase the copper setters that the meters fit in to make this change easier and without a lot of extra work on the water department. So we, considering that number of meters and the costs associated with it, we took a couple of bids for the copper setters and all the parts that go along with it to make the meter change easy. First bid, let's see, we had a $68,250 bid from Midwest Meter, and Illinois Meter gave a bid of $61,508, which is the bid that I would recommend the council approving. Obviously a pretty good savings there. Buying these meters in bulk does save us a considerable amount of money versus the way we do it, just buying them, you know, a few at a time as we need them. So the big purchase is in line with what we want to do.
Okay, you want to go ahead and discuss these position changes, which I think were all planned, but just run through them, make sure everybody.
Yeah, the position changes basically are just backfilling positions that were vacated. When we did the change in leadership, we promoted Cliff Hogue to the lead of the water department, which vacated the position of lead man, which is a union position. We needed to fill that, and we've got Scott Clara. He's the most qualified and has the most tenure of anyone down there to fill that position. That's our man for that job. Colin Basham will backfill the job that Scott is vacating. So that fills those two positions. Tyler Smith is one that kind of must have fell through the cracks at some point. Tyler is basically a lead man down there over the distribution of the water, if you will. He is the man in the lab. He does all the testing, does all the bacteria testing, all the new testing that's coming out with the EPA. He keeps up with those regulations. His title is chief operator. And for some reason, his pay has not reflected that, and we need to get him up to that pay also. He's very deserving of this, and he adds a lot of value. He was very instrumental in helping Marion through the water crisis that we had with Wren Lake a few years ago. He probably kept us in water, which if we would have run out of water at that time, we would have many main breaks. It would have cost us thousands and thousands of dollars. He was on top of this. Like I said, his worth to the city is why we have him on here to move him in to the pay scale that he really should be getting for a chief operator. It's the same pay as the lead man, but we need to bring both those guys up to that pay. And then the final position is in the wastewater department. The hire here, John Bone, was the position was intended to be full-time permanent with benefits. During the pandemic, we had a lot of we had furloughed people. We needed to get somebody working down there. John agreed to come to work as a temporary part-time employee just to get him in there. He hit the ground running. He's been doing the work the full-time guys are doing. Now's the time to bring him up to what we promised him to begin with. And I think that was all.
Okay. You guys have any questions on any of those items, A or B, of Brent while he's here? If not, could we have a motion on A, please?
I make a motion to approve the bid from IMCO for copper settings to conclude the water meter replacement project at a cost of $61,508.50, which is a budgeted item.
I'll second that.
Okay, roll call, please.
Commissioner Patton?
Yay.
Commissioner Barwick?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Stecklin?
Yay.
Mayor Absher?
Yay. Item B here is pretty well spelled out, and so at the interest of efficiency, I think it's fine to make your motion, whoever's making that, just as presented, so we don't have to, or you can read the whole thing. It's up to you.
I would make a motion to approve the following budgeted water and sewer department promotions as presented.
I'll second that.
Okay, roll call, please.
Commissioner Patton?
Yay.
Commissioner Barwick?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Stecklin?
Yay.
Mayor Absher?
Yay. Item 8, police department. I think, Commissioner Barwick, you had a clarification on this item, and I don't remember exactly what you told me, so.
Yes, this was a budgeted item. It says it's non-budgeted, but it was in the budget. But we found a way to make this purchase without using the actual budgeted money.
Oh, okay.
Grant from our liability insurance company. That's a matching
speaking
grant.
To this item, too?
If you need me to.
You sure? You got something to say? Say it.
Only if you have questions.
Okay. We've been looking for the funding for this for quite a while, and I think Brian Fisher was involved in securing these, and maybe quite a few other people. I know you were too. Anybody else on the grant funding part securing that?
That was mainly it.
Brian?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay. Your department, you want to make that motion, John?
Yes, I'd make a motion that we would approve the purchase of new tasers and equipment using grant, drug, and operating funds as necessary.
A budgeted item, then?
A budgeted item.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, you guys have any questions of the chief relative to this equipment? Or I know our old stuff's about expired, the old equipment, so we need
it. It isn't necessarily expired. The problem that we have is there was only one company in the country that makes this product. So we are at their mercy. And the taser that we have now, they have stopped producing that. They have stopped producing any spare parts, so to speak, and they don't guarantee those any longer.
What happens to the old equipment when we replace this?
Well, if we still have the batteries and the charges for them, we will hang on to them if we have malfunctions on some other equipment.
Cody has long wanted to be tased.
For him to carry one, he has to be tased.
What was that?
For anybody to carry one, they have to be tased.
No, I don't need him to carry one. I just want him to be tased.
That's your call, sir. You're okay. The boss.
We'll come with a rubber mat. Okay.
Dave, I see 15 on here, but yet there's 30 other parts and pieces. I'm assuming the quantity is 15, correct?
15 tasers, and the 30 that you see is actual charges, so that's two charges per taser, two training rounds per taser, and 15 holsters.
Are those rounds reusable?
They are not.
So if you tase somebody, you got to go buy another round?
Yes, sir.
That's why we're using the old stuff on Cody.
And those are readily available?
Yes.
Has that been one of our problems, is that it's only this one company? Are they proprietary? Does the charge specific to that manufacturer of a taser, or are those interchangeable?
Taser's the only company out there.
Well, you said this. We're held hostage to this one company of our equipment now, so what company is that? Is it Taser?
It is. It's now owned by Axon.
Okay.
But yes.
So it's the only game in town?
Yes, sir.
The problem is they're not making those replaceable parts
because of
anymore.
The equipment's that
yeah.
model, older model.
Model, right.
I don't want to say something publicly that somebody can go research and go, oh, Chief was wrong. There is a website where you can go and buy used ones, but Taser wouldn't warranty those. And if someone got injured using one of those, nobody would be backed.
You're saying we don't buy our weaponry on eBay?
We do not.
Okay. Any other questions of the chief before he steps away?
We have a motion.
Okay, so we're ready for roll call?
Yes.
Roll call, please.
Commissioner Patton?
Yay.
Commissioner Barwick?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Stecklin?
Yay.
Mayor Abshire?
Yay. We've got four things under economic development and municipal planning. A is, there you are, an amendment to this one TIF. Yeah. And I asked you already.
Yeah, you had asked me to clarify that. So basically, we're, the original agreement was just under Little Tractor and Equipment, LLC. We're adding two people and an LLC to this. It's a nuance in how their corporations are set up. It has nothing material changes to the agreement as it is. It's just a name change only.
Okay, that would be my motion to approve Ordinance 3631 as presented.
I'll second that motion.
Any questions of Cody on that one? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Patton?
Yay.
Commissioner Barwick?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Stecklin?
Yay.
Mayor Abshire?
Yay. Item 9B is Ordinance 3632, another redevelopment agreement with SS Fowler LLC. That's Steve and Sherry, right? That's the SS, not Super Sport like Chevrolet?
Well, it could be.
It could be in your case, for sure. No secret, I think that you guys are going to rehabilitate one of the older buildings here on the square. That's what this agreement is. We're all excited about that. It's a long time in coming. So we appreciate you and your dedication to doing that. So I'll also make that motion to approve Ordinance 3632, redevelopment agreement with SS Fowler LLC.
I'll second that.
Any questions on that or that project? Roll call, please.
Commissioner Patton?
Yay.
Commissioner Barwick?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Stecklin?
Yay.
Mayor Abshire?
Yay. Item 9C is Ordinance 3633, sort of a standalone, but it happens to be in that same development as Steve and Sherry are doing. That's my motion to approve Ordinance 3633, a redevelopment agreement with Seasoning LLC.
I'll second that motion.
Roll call, please.
Commissioner Patton?
Yay.
Commissioner Barwick?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Stecklin?
Yay.
Mayor Abshire?
Yay. Okay, Glenn, are you still here? Can you come up and talk about item 9D? I just want to make sure everybody understands this. This project is long in coming, and pardon the pun, but there's some twists and turns that have happened in it as we've sought state grant funding for Westminster Drive. And I had an email. Reason I want you to clarify exactly what we're doing again, I had an email from a constituent asking a question about something that must have been discussed on this project well before I was in office, and said that he thought we already had the funding to this. And because I said we're kind of waiting on hearing back from the state, and we just did this week for certain. So just kind of describe what's going on at Westminster again for everybody. I felt like this particular constituent didn't really believe me or think I knew what I was talking about. I just think it's changed since whenever the council talked about it before. So
this originated 3 or 4 years ago, and originally we were not going to have curbing. We was going to widen it, resurface it, have open ditches, and do it for $400,000 or $500,000. When the state says we're going to replace the bridge, we're going to bring Halfway Road, they are under contract, down to Fossey Road. That left the road uncompleted from Fossey to Carbon. We went to IDOT and tried to get a grant, and we originally tried to get a $750,000 grant. By adding curb and gutter, storm sewer, inlets, sidewalk, the project is now estimated as $1.4 million. Instead of getting $750,000 grant, in essence, we're getting $400,000 from the state. $300,000 as a grant, approximately $100,000 to do the construction and staking and all the engineering of the construction. As it now stands, the contract for letting of the bridge will be in July the 30th of 2021. They're going to incorporate the plans that City of Marion is preparing on Westminster Drive in with their contract, and it will be let, and the state of Illinois will be obligated to pay for the bridge and Westminster all the way down to including Carbon. Okay, they'll be paying for that. Now, how do we pay the state back for about $1 million. Well, under the Build Illinois Bond Act that was recently passed, Marion will get about $388,000 a year for 3 years, which is $1.1 million. If we obligate that $1.1 million along with the $300,000 grant, we've got our money to pay for the $1.4 million, which puts us to the top flight first class road from Fossey east to Carbon, including the Carbon intersection. And that's kind of where we're standing now. The engineering, this contract pertains to this. The original contract was for the minor, for the smaller project. When we expanded it and carried on, we revised the contract, and that's what you're approving tonight, is to about 59 more thousand to get the rest of the plans and specifications complete. It's the city's responsibility to draw up the plans, specifications, prepare the project report, and to acquire the necessary rights of way needed for the project. We have to have that complete and back to Carbondale by March the 1st. Then they'll incorporate that into their bid letting. It's scheduled for July. Construction will probably start in September of 2021, and so we won't have any payments to make to the state until probably the beginning of 2022.
Did you say that the, I thought first I heard, I may have misheard, the bid letting would not be till July of 2021, but you meant 2020, right? Or I misheard it?
No, it's 2021.
The bid letting? When is the bridge actually going to be replaced?
Well, that will be let in July. They'll probably award the contract and time all the papers are complete in September, possibly. And September of 2021 was when construction of the bridge and the carrying of the road from the bridge east to Fossey Road.
But we don't know what the specific time frame on that is?
We'll be close. It'll be in the fall of 2021.
Well, one of the reasons is the community needs to be aware when this happens, they're not only replacing these original bridges to 57, are they not?
They were the ones that was originally put in 1963.
So they are original. They are 30 feet wide, I believe, is that or thereabouts, and we'd be replacing them with, or however they are, they're wider, right?
They're wider bridges. What the problem started is that it has a weight limit. If you've driven over them, you'll see a weight limit on the bridge. When Cape Line, Maine, has got a big, huge booster station at the end of Westminster. You go and you go west, you turn south, and they got 650 horsepower motors there. They had to replace one of those huge motors. The truck couldn't, with the weight limit, couldn't get over the bridge. It had to go to Pepsi-Cola, drive through the field to get down and miss the bridge to get down and replace the pump. And that was crucial to keeping that pump station operating.
But this is, the community needs to keep this in mind when they bring these in. Both lanes of 57 will be closed for the duration of them replacing these bridges, because they're doing both at the same time.
57 lanes will be closed for one or no more than 2 days.
Yeah,
maximum. Now the road, while they're replacing the bridge, that utilizing Westminster will be shut down while the bridge is being replaced. We did this so that the state of Illinois could save $750,000 without having to build a detour bridge while they were doing that.
Okay.
And that helped us get the $400,000 in the grant portion.
So
it will be fall of 2021 before work will commence. And IDOT will be responsible for the payment of the contractor for the portion of Westminster from Fossey to Carbon. And it will be the city's obligation then to pay IDOT back.
IDOT will pay for all portions, and then we repay IDOT.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Either through the bond money,
yes,
or for some reason that doesn't come to fruition, IDOT, I've heard from the director myself at lunch this week, or last week, they'll work out an alternative arrangement,
yep,
with us. They don't really have an alternative at that point. They have to do this work. So
we're in the process of negotiating the agreement and preparing it now. So that will be put into the agreement.
Glenn, the intersection with Carbon Street will be a center turn lane with the permanent lights, too.
We'll have the lights will be, what's there now, temporary.
Yeah.
They'll be replaced with mast arms, permanent lights. There'll be left turn lanes on Carbon and Westminster.
Will those be video controlled or pressure controlled?
Be video.
Video.
Yeah. The video control will run. We just got we're replacing it. Sinclair Drive, those signal lights are going to be replaced with videos. And the city paid $17,000 for that, and the state of Illinois paid $17,000. And video is what operates Halfway Road in West Main, and that functions real good. But it costs us about $15,000 more to get video over radar. Any questions?
Okay, what's your pleasure?
I'd make a motion to approve the Clarita Ziegler Engineering revised Westminster Drive contract. The city has already paid $58,500 of the $117,000 design engineering fee and $8,410 of the $14,000 right-of-way.
Second that.
Okay, roll call, please.
Commissioner Patton?
Yay.
Commissioner Barwick?
Yay.
Commissioner Webb?
Yay.
Commissioner Stecklin?
Yay.
Mayor Abscher?
Yay. Commissioner reports, we'll start with you, Mr. Barwick.
Okay, start with the Marion Police Department Narcotics Unit for the month of June. There were 15 case initiations, made 14 arrests, 3 federal indictments, 1 search warrant, 2 consent searches, 2 firearms were seized, 2 controlled drug purchases of crystal meth, cocaine, 1 meth manufacturing and materials case, 1,640 grams of cannabis, 5.5 grams of powder cocaine, 6 grams of crystal ice, 2 MDMA tablets, 37 prescription tablets, and $17,823.90 of United States currency was awarded to the Marion Police Department from previous forfeiture to be utilized in drug fund. And there was 1 vehicle seized for asset forfeiture. And the Marion Police Department for June 2020, there were 34 city ordinance violations, 10 warrant arrests, 279 incidents reported, 109 traffic accidents, 2 DUIs. There were 4,708 dispatched calls, 2,756 911 calls, and 200 ambulance calls. Police department was busy.
Sounds like it.
And for the Marion Fire Department, there were 16 fire calls, 1 explosion type call, 8 rescue and EMS calls, 17 hazardous conditions with no fire, 8 service calls, 4 good intent calls, 10 activated alarms, for a total of 64 calls. There was 5 inspections completed and a total hours of shift training of 751. They were also busy.
Okay. Just to change it up, Commissioner Webb.
Yeah, the paving program for the street department is about finished. We have a contractor working on that, so everything's looking good on the pavement. We're continuing work on the sidewalks, our brush clearing, ditch cleaning, what have you. The pavement striping is going good. That's something we do in-house. It's a little different than most towns, and I've seen the paving on it, or striping today, and everything's looking good on that. Cemetery, the grass keeps us busy out there, trying to keep it mowed, so everything's good.
Mr. Stecklin?
Okay, water department, we had 1 new tap this month, 14 updated services, 5 main breaks, replaced a new fire hydrant. I like to give little tidbits of trivia and stuff each month just because I find it fascinating. You know, we repaired a 1/8 inch hole in one of our water lines this month. And just to put that in perspective, an 1/8 inch hole can produce a loss of 3,600 gallons a day at 2.5 gallons a minute. So you can see what a little pinhole in a water line would do as far as leaks go. We also did 302 Julie locates. Other hat. Oh, wait, I also want to talk about water usage. Again, trivia, 60 million gallons, almost 61 million gallons for the month of June. So just an immense amount of water usage in the city. And then 4th of July update, I just want to thank the citizens and everybody, the city, the police, the fire, everybody else who came out, made it a safe an enjoyable 4th of July fireworks display for the city again. So appreciate everybody's help with that. So that is all.
It was a heck of a fireworks show.
Yeah.
I'll say that. Mr. Patton.
I have municipal sales tax results for the month of April. I know we were worried about it, but good news. We were only down 11.4%.
Wow.
And I think we were expecting
20-ish.
Yeah. That is very good news. Carbondale, for instance, was down 29.3%. Mount Vernon down 17%. Effingham down 8%, almost 9%. This is the one that rocked my socks. Fairview Heights down 48.8%. Belleville down 7% and O'Fallon down 12%. So we're hanging with the big boys. I love that. And it's nothing but positive outlook for City of Marion coming up.
Did you ever think that with a 10% drop in sales tax revenue, we'd be saying is a good thing?
Yeah, saying we were happy with that.
But in everything in context, yes, right? And absolutely. So we are well-equipped. I hope things stay along this track. We are well-equipped to handle this kind of a disaster because our predecessors, to give them credit, put some money back, and it's not all – it's sitting in the bank earning interest, and we don't have to fire everybody, so – that's what reserves are for, is emergencies. Yes, sir.
I've got one more thing I'd like to say, if I could. We hear on the news, everyone's down in the police and defund the police. I just want to say that our police and our fire department here in Marion, I'm very proud of them. And I think we have the best police and fire department in the area. And just want to let them know that, speaking for myself anyway, we have their back and very proud of them. Right.
Did you have something to say?
Start off with shame on me. When we was recognizing people at the beginning, I omitted a couple people. Oftentimes, it's very easy to forget the dispatchers, which is what I just did. So I do want to recognize Justin Wing, Holly Beasley, and Jason Hintz. They were the ones on the radio, and all three of them participated in the calls to help save Terrence's niece.
I'm glad you remember to do that. I sometimes forget somebody's got to answer the phone and talk to the people while the officers are on the way.
Yeah, I said Jason Hintz. It's Jordan Hintz.
Okay. Well, I'm glad you clarified that, both of you. One thing in miscellaneous that I wanted to bring up and just take your temperature on. I would like to propose that we move our city council meetings till 5:30 as opposed to 6:30. You got a funny look on your face. Just twice a month, John.
Fine. Yeah, that'll be fine.
Works what do you me. Think?
Sure.
John?
I'm good.
Okay, that will take an ordinance, which we'll do at the next meeting, and that has to be so much notice before that can go into effect because we state our meeting dates by ordinance, but we just have had some late nights, depending on the order of business. And honestly, we're just sitting here from 5:30 to 6:30 waiting on it to start anyway most of the time. So I'm glad you guys agree with me. Make it so, Cody. Make it so. All right. Anything else to come before the council in miscellaneous? All right. We do have need for a closed or executive session. And that would be my motion, which is going to involve there's only specific reasons we can meet. There's two of them that qualify tonight, sale and lease of public property and litigation considerations. So that would be my motion. But before we vote on that or take a second on that, I just want to remind the public and those on the camera, we hold these at the end of the meeting, not in the middle of the meeting, for one specific purpose, and that's so that everybody else in the audience can go home. We do not make any take any action or make any decisions after this vote that we're getting ready to take, which is to go into closed session. When closed session ends, we simply vote to come back into open session and adjourn the meeting. So we don't do anything from here on out. That's why I always have it on the agenda at the end, is for your benefit. What sometimes happens is that we have substantial business to talk about, and that lasts much longer than you see, which is another reason why I want to move it to 5:30. So anyway, that's my motion, is to move into executive session based on sale of lease of property and litigation. I would entertain a second, please.
I'll second that motion.
Okay, roll call, please.
Commissioner Patton.
Yay.
Commissioner Barwick.
Yay.
Commissioner Webb.
Yay.
Commissioner Stecklin.
Yay.
Mayor Abshire.
Yay. I think we'll stay in here tonight just for your gentlemen's benefit, so we can spread out a little bit. So we'll just wait till everybody else clears out, so have a bathroom break or something, and we'll adjourn back in closed session.